another word for it. But that we're just saying just now is that we are changed in His presence. Wow. Is it not then important that we seek His presence more? Because that's where the change comes. But there is a problem. For that change to happen, we have to want the change. God will not force change. He wants us to change. Because that's the relationship. Changing switch for the yellow world for life. He wants us to change, but He's not going to force us. So that's why it's so important that we, when there's gatherings, that we join in these gatherings and that we learn together. Because that's change. Good evening. Welcome to everybody. We've got guests this evening. Welcome. It's an honor to be standing in front of you. And I've got something this evening that I want to share to you about. I don't want to say it's about myself, but it's coming to about me. As you saw on the group I was sharing with Prophet yesterday, when he put the name on the group, I looked at it and I thought to myself, but that's not the name that I gave him. So where did he get the name that I chose? And I just laughed about it. The word poimen. I want to share with you a little bit about this word this evening, poimen. It is somewhere between God's calling for a man and a broken person. A person that needs help, a person that needs a hand, or a person that needs encouragement. Between those persons, there's a person, a specialist, called to the office to serve. And that specialist is called a shepherd. He is called by Jesus Himself. Most people know Him by His name. But when He's expected to come to the rescue, when He's expected to help in need, people calls Him pastor. To His wife, He's a hero most of the times. To His children, He's a stranger. Someone whose mother is very proud of Him. His number is on almost everybody's phone number, on the emergency contact list. For His colleagues at work, in His presence, you don't use foul language. In His presence, you don't stand and talk behind somebody else's back, off somebody. That's the guy when he comes in that it looks like sometimes guys are swallowing their cigarettes. He's the guy that's not invited to a bride because his friends might feel offended because they cannot drink. To most people, he's a dear friend. He's the go-to-go person when someone needs help. When somebody needs advice. When somebody needs a word of encouragement. When the medics come on the scene, when they arrive on the scene, he's the one that's called. When a child needs to be married, he's the one that's being called. When a family member is in hospital, he's the one that's called. But he's the one that don't have the time to even fix the little things in and around the house. The pastor is the one whose job, call it a job, is to marry the young lovers who must pray for the sick and must bury the dead. And after all of this, he still has to have time to prepare for Sunday evening and for Sunday morning. How else can I describe a pastor this evening? A financial expert when people are in financial trouble. A public relation expert. He's a counselor in the church. He's a diplomat. He's a business guru. He is the evangelist of the church. He is the prophet of the church. He's the janitor. He's the cleaner. He's the one that makes sure the windows and the blinds is correct and in line. He's the one that's making sure that the gardener is doing the job. And he is the one that has to look after the sheep and attend to the lost ones. Does that sound like the pastor to you? To most people, yes. To most people, yes. All of the above is more than often true. But what then is the duty of the pastor, of the shepherd? There are two aspects that I want to share with you to the calling, the office of a pastor. The first is pastoring, also called shepherding. And the second is teaching. The pastoring aspect of the pastor's ministry emphasizes care to the congregation, the flock given to him by Jesus. The pastor leads, he feeds, he guards and he comforts, he encourages, he rescues, he heals the wounds of the people, his people. He has to take the lead with the prayer gatherings, be available at any time when a person is in need of him, when a person needs advice. When the unexpected happens during the week, he is the one that has to help. Many don't discern this, but you can ask. This can be very and extremely draining. He is expected to be on the front line for justice and for mercy, for forgiveness and for redemption, trying to figure out what the people need to overcome their mountain, to overcome their problems, so that they can walk in victory, so that they can walk victorious. One thing is sure, a pastor can't do this on his own. He can't do it on his own strength, on his own abilities. He cannot rely on himself. Then there is the teaching aspect of his calling. A teacher, as teacher, he focuses on communicating the Word of God. That is the spiritual food that the congregation, that the sheep is needing for growing, for the congregation, for understanding and for application. This is by lecturing, asking questions in the home group, by discussing, by questions, and by being a demonstration in the house. We all understand this. A person's health, his growing and his living in all aspects of life, goes hand in hand with the spiritual food that you receive. The spiritual food that we eat, that you eat yourself. And I've got to say this tonight. This is not about receiving. We can receive something but don't do anything with it. This is about what you receive and make it yours, that you eat. So what am I saying? The Bible is not for surviving. It is for us to grow, for us to become strong and healthy. That's why it's important that a preacher does not preach survival anymore. It's not about survival. It's about God's love. It's about conquering. There are various styles of teaching. But the task given to the pastor by Jesus himself will always be the same. To bring the Word of God, and that's called the office, to the congregation. To equip them and prepare them for their ministry out there where they find themselves. At home, at the workplace, even in the market. That's called the gift. The pastor's job title, if I can call it that, is to pastor and to teach. And these two cannot be separated. From Ephesians 4 verse 11, we see Paul describing the fivefold ministry given by Jesus to those he appointed in these offices. And his gifts were, it varied. He himself appointed and gave men to us. Some to be apostles, special messengers. Some prophets, inspired teachers, preachers and expounders. Some evangelists, preachers of the gospel, traveling missionaries. Some pastors, shepherds of his flock and teachers. I underlined this in my Bible and I underlined it this evening as well, of his flock. It's not about the flock that we're taking care of, it's his. You sitting here tonight have to remember one thing, you are God's. And I've got to take care of you as if you are God's, like you are God's own personal property. You are his sons and daughters. And that's why it's such a great responsibility to stand here. Am I correct by saying only a few, only a selected few is selected? Yes. Everyone cannot stand there in the front and minister. But everyone can at home be of service. Everyone are equipped to be of service at his workplace, in the marketplace. I want to call Gabby and I want to call Rika to the front. I've got something for them. And I said to them, this is theirs. It's theirs. It's a gift. Thank you. I want them to have it. The same is with our gifts. The problem with gifts is, Gabby's busy destroying the paper to get the gift out there. Rika put it somewhere because she will open it later. That's how it goes with our gifts. That's how it goes with that we receive from the front. That God is sharing with us the message of this morning, God's need. We all received it, but how many is eagerly opened it and taking it for themselves. Every born again believer received gifts. Do you agree with me? Every born again believer received gifts. And we will discuss this. Somewhere in the future we're going to discuss it. Prophet explained it Sunday evening. Many received the gifts, but few opened it. Few was eagerly open it to make it theirs. Excited about the contents of what's inside the wrapping. Few claimed it. Does not matter how you look at it. Pastoring is given by Jesus not just to shepherd the church, but to attend to and to lead to pastors. Pastures. Jesus is the giver of the fivefold ministry. Will you agree with me? For him to be able to, for him to be the giver of this gift, of the fivefold ministry, it means it's his. It is his, he owns it exclusively, it's his. With this in mind, I am certain that all that were called into this office received the same gifts. There is no bigger gift to someone and a lesser gift to another one. The gift of the office is the same. The thing is, the gift that we received is as powerful, as big as we make it. But I want to say to you tonight as well, the gift that you received is as powerful, and as great as you make it. You determine the power of the gift that you received. Either you work it and you are able to pay back the owner of the gifts who gave it to you, or you become like I said to Ben on Friday, or you become like the person who received the gift and who hides it. And one day when you have to report back on that you received, you've got nothing to show except for that you received. We received something to work with. We did not receive that to put it in a cupboard. We did not receive it to leave it somewhere. And hopefully one day it's still there when I have to report on the debt that I received. I shared with Prophet yesterday a story that I read of in the pyramids, that they found this one tomb. And in the tomb there was this clay vase with seed in it. They're not sure what seed, but for how many years has that seed been in that vase and it was not growing because it was hidden away? Imagine if that seed got into the ground. It will grow. Does not matter how old that seed is. Allow me to share something worthwhile remembering tonight. The English word for pastor comes from the Latin word pastor, which means a herdsman or a shepherd. It is related to the Latin verb pasco, which means to cause, to eat, to feed, or to supply with food. In the Hebrew, the word pastor, poimen, means sheep herder. The Greek verb for pastor means to herd, to attend to lead to better pastures. Combining the two verbs, a pastor feeds, he protects, and he leads. I will never forget the picture of my dad that's still in my head somewhere. Every morning, not always the same times, but every morning, he had his special time with the Lord. Bible study and crying. I remember him crying and crying. But I never fully understood that. Today, as a pastor myself, I understand. My dad never once, and I believe that, never once cried for himself. I think my dad never cried for the family. He cried before God for his flock, for the people that he visited, for the ones he saw a potential in, but that did not want to change. Barquis, he cried before God because of the blind people and the deaf people in the church. His heart was for the church. His heart was the people. A while back, I listened to a sermon where a preacher raised a question, and he was raising this question to preachers and to pastors, to teachers. And he asked, who is your pastor? A question that I think all of us can answer. Who is your pastor? As a pastor, a teacher in this house, I have to adhere to Jesus first of all. I have to answer to Prophet Anton and to the church board. I learn from Prophet Anton as the father of this house. He said yesterday, I'm not the dad of this house. I said, that's fine. You're the father of this house. And I appreciate him for that. I honor him for that. And I adhere to him as my senior. And he was given by God also for me to learn from. While pondering on all of this, Psalm 23 came to mind. And I want to share this with you from the New King James. Let me picture to you the function of a pastor in this well-known psalm that we've got. The Lord is my poimen, my shepherd, my pastor. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He provides us with food and He's guiding us. He teaches and He is looking out for the wolves and the predators who is always stalking the flock. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters, feeding the sheep. Make sure He gives them nutritious food to feed on, to satisfy them. Guiding, comforting, being a lookout for the flock, loving the flock, not wanting to see any of them getting lost or devoured by wolves and by the predators. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Renewing the sheep when wandering away. Bringing them back to the flock. He is watching out for our welfare. Guiding us into the right paths. Warning us about false teachings. Warning us about the things that's happening around us that we don't see. Yeah. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil. For You are with me, Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. Accompanying the flock so that they will not be alone ever. When last did you go for a walk? Well, most of us have the opportunity to go for a walk in the evenings. When last did you go for a walk? I cannot imagine myself you going for a walk with this. I can see myself fending off dogs and things chasing us with a stick like this. This is the rod that's protecting us. This is for guiding us. This is for keeping us close, keeping us together. The rod literally is a club for defense. The staff is a cane to lean on as a support in one's weariness. And this speaks of protection against the enemy. Also, support in weakness. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy. You anointed my head with oil. My cup runs over. Sustenance, feeding and nourishing the flock with abundance. No flock wants only a little. A flock wants enough. But sometimes you bring the flock to the right pastures and they don't eat. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. If you are well fed, and if you are taken care of, I think it's easier to stay in the house, or to stay in that field that is given to you to feed in. But if you're not looked after, and if you're not well fed, then you start looking for other pastures. Groenweivelde. Every thought that was mentioned in Psalm 23, that we read just now, tells something about a pastor's business. Each thought gives a picture of a caring, of a loving, of a protecting. And the foundation of all of this, a gift by Jesus given to a person that wants to fulfill that calling. Applying Psalm 23 to the ministry, the divine shepherd should give new and fresh meaning to pastoral work and the importance of it. That is tender love, care, and devoting all of God's love to the people. That is why it's called an office. From the Bible, Let me share with you some aspects of shepherding and pastoring and teaching. Just a few that I want to share with you. And I want to start with Isaiah. We see, tend to the flock, protect and care for the sheep and the lambs, lead the nursing ewes. These are figures of speech, of protection, accompanying, sympathy, as well as feeding. The picture he creates is that of leadership, of protection, as well as authority. Jeremiah portrays the shepherd as the one who watches to ensure that the flock do not scatter because of wolves, because of predators, or get confused. Ezekiel warns the shepherds not to fail their task in feeding the flock, strengthening, healing, searching for, and protecting the sheep. Zechariah cries out to the people, they need a shepherd for their own welfare. Psalm 23, the ideal shepherd, Jesus, the perfect example to be imitated, leads and he feeds. He refreshes, he encourages and he calms, he protects and he comforts the people. The New Testament portrays the shepherd's ministry in a very similar way. Matthew states that people who have no leader and standards by which to live by are like sheep without a shepherd. Mark shows Jesus as a shepherd with real compassion. Why? Because Jesus said that the sheep scatters when there is no sheep herder. Jesus told Peter in the book of John to take care of the sheep for which he was responsible. He was given the flock. It is an important task given to Peter, to the pastor. Luke wrote that Paul instructed the elders to shepherd God's flock, the church in Miletus. Paul writes in Ephesians that Jesus gifted people to equip the believers for their ministry so that the church would be edified, would be built up. You see, it's easy to say, and I said it earlier, it's easy to say it's the pastor's job to go get the people. It's the pastor's job to go visit the sick. It's the pastor's job. Can I tell you something? You are gifted to do that. It is your responsibility to build the church. Him standing in front is equipping you by the word of God for you to do the work. But certain people, and I don't want to say it in that way, but certain people became so lazy that they sit back and you've got to spoon feed them. And if you don't feed them enough, they are angry. They go look for something else. Yes, Paul is saying that the shepherd feeds the people, teaching them and equipping them to go out and edify the church. That is building the church. Hebrews speak of men who teach the word of God and keep watch over the flock, being vigilant and alert. And adding to that instruction, he says, fulfilling this great responsibility joyfully. Can I tell you something? That's not always easy. The joyfully part is not always easy. Not because of what God is giving us, because of the flock. Peter is giving sound advice to the shepherds. He's saying, by example of how Christ, the chief shepherd, shepherd his flock, called by him, lead like that. Is Jesus still shepherding the flock today? Yes, He's shepherding by the shepherd and the pastor in the front. He's using them to shepherd the flock. That's why it is such a responsibility that you've been called by Jesus to do what he's doing. And I want to add to that. This morning we heard God's need. That is part of God's need, that the flock is looked after. Where did this all start for me? Where did this start for me? And my scripture comes from 1 Peter 5, verse 1 to 5. And I want to share something with you private that's in my Bible. I wrote it, and I'm going to share that with you tonight. One example is worth a thousand arguments. In different times, people don't need dictators and arguments. They need a shepherd who will show what to do by the example of his life. I ask myself a question. Cobus, what kind of shepherd will you be? Jesus himself shepherds the flock through the shepherds called by him. I cannot stand in this office all by myself. I stand on Jesus' calling. I stand on the ones that he's giving me around me to support me and help me. I can't do this by myself. Therefore, he gives me Holy Spirit, his word, and his instructions. Shepherd as one shepherded by Christ. Then looking at verse 2 from the new version. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, literally. Shepherd the sheep given to you. Not just be a shepherd, but do the work of shepherding what Jesus requires from you. This is what I've wrote for myself. So where did it start for me? When I gave my heart to Jesus? No. When I got baptized? No. When I started Bible school? No. The seed was given to me right in the beginning. That calling was given to me right in the beginning. I had to come to a place where I accepted the calling. God planted that seed in the beginning in my heart, just as he did in others. As I spent time in his word, Holy Spirit started to water that seed. And I allowed the desire to grow in my heart. I allowed it to grow to become what he called me to do. And this desire became a calling of which I chose to unwrap the gift given to me by Jesus. To do the good works as he did by example. What helped me to unwrap the gift, I will share with you now. But before I do that, I want to give a few of these. Wat moet je aan zo? Dat is niet vereerd. Nee, dat is niet verkeerd. Nee, man. If you look at this seed, what do you see? It's lots of seed, and there's different seeds. But all the seeds that I'm having in my hand, that I'm giving to you, it's just seed. Nothing will come of this seed until we do something with it. Until such time that we take the seed and we claim it, we make it ours, nothing will come with the seed. Sorry. I passed, sorry for you to have a look. The same is with our desires. If we don't have a desire to see the seed grow, it's not going to grow. What helped me to unwrap this gift that was given to me? I want to share Ephesians 2 verse 10 with you. For we are God's own handiwork, His workmanship, recreated in Christ Jesus, born anew, that we may do those good works which God predestined, planned beforehand for us, taking paths which He prepared ahead of time, that we should walk in them, live the good life which He prearranged and made ready for us to live in. This is something that each and every one of us received. Maybe you're not in the office, but you've got the gift. And as long as you have the gift and you're not like Gabby, tearing it open to see what's inside and devour it. Sorry, Gabby, but to eat it, to enjoy it, it will just be a gift. Your gift. God never gave us the gifts like the office, like me as pastor, as shepherd. God never gave it to me for myself. God gave it for the church. The same with the church growing. We are so quick to look at the pastor. Where's the new people? When are we going out to evangelists? When are we going out to do this? When are? But we forget it's not his responsibility. The responsibility is to feed the flock. And the flock must go out. The flock becomes equipped to do the work. A shepherd feeds, he guards, he nurses, he leads. When there's an attack, he gathers the sheep together and chases off the attacker. That's his responsibility. When a sheep becomes injured or sick, he tries to repair the damage and heal the sheep. When fear knocks on the door, such as a storm or a potential attack, he gathers the sheep and he comforts the flock. The same responsibilities and the same tasks were given to the shepherd of the sheep. That same task, that same responsibilities has been given to the pastor, to the teacher. All to help with spiritual growth, spiritual healing, encouraging, caring for the congregation. Why is it important for the shepherd to feed the sheep and to take care of them? Because that is what is expected from the shepherd? Yeah. Because he was called for it? Yeah. Because the sheep is valuable? Yes. But there's something else I want to share with you. This to me was, wow, serious? What does a sheep give? Wat gee 'n skaap? Give. Wool. Well-fed and well-taken care of sheep gain weight. And that helps them producing good and quality wool. The wool becomes the product used in homes, in workplaces, in marketplaces, where people wear it as clothes, to cover themselves as blankets, to warm themselves. The wool becomes the evidence of the shepherd looking after his flock. The wool is the evidence of his caring for them, of his keeping them safe. A few examples that I've got so that you understand what I'm saying. Take Martha this morning. Martha stands up. And the wool that she's offering is a testimony unto the house. Tanisari. There's not a Sunday that she's not prepared to drive up and down to bring others to church. To be here with her. That's wool that the sheep gives. Wednesday, Yolanda was sharing with us, if I may, Yolanda, was sharing with us at school. When a child is in despair, when a child is crying or unhappy, she calls the child one side and she prays for him. That's wool, that's evidence of a sheep looked after. The pastoring aspect of the pastor and the teacher's ministry emphasizes caring for and of the congregation. Neither of the two may be neglected. If so, the sheep becomes undernourished and susceptible to a multitude of physical, mental, as well as spiritual diseases. As a pastor, a teacher, I have to teach the Word of God. But the balance must be kept. Pastoring the congregation as well as teaching them. What would you say is the best part of a shepherd's day? A good part of the shepherd's ministry is feeding the flock with spiritual food. In insight. Near. With the Word of God. But the pastor also has the privilege and the responsibility to shepherd the congregation given to him by our Lord Jesus. Leading, protecting, rescuing, healing, and comforting the flock, his congregation. If you see this picture, you will also see that it is nothing short of warfare. Many might not realize it, but warfare is not just time consuming. It is draining, and it is often discouraging. Crying for the flock, fighting the fights, yes, but the blessing in it is not only a satisfaction for the pastor, for the teacher, but it becomes a blessing unto the congregation. It becomes a blessing to the people. 1 Timothy 1 verse 16 says, but I obtained mercy for the reason that in me, as the foremost of sinners, Jesus Christ might be shown forth and display all his perfect long sufferings and patience for an example to encourage those who thereafter believe on him for the gaining of eternal life. The example that Jesus set was take care, look after, protect. It takes courage to join this family, this flock that is so misunderstood by the world. It takes discipline to accomplish the tasks given to God, given by God, that God had set for each and every one of us. It takes vision to overcome inevitable problems and to see what God is busy doing in the lives of his children. What God is busy doing in the lives of the people. It takes endurance to stick with brothers and sisters in Christ when it would be so much easier to go on your own. To stick it out. It takes love to hold God's family together and to reach out and invite others to join in. The love it takes is tender, yet tough, sacrificial, and in many times, it's radical love. I've asked Scotty, but Johannes in the back, to play us a song. And there's something that, in short, that I want to end off with. What is the responsibilities of the pastor? What is the responsibilities of the congregation? As shepherd, labor. Not a once a week job. To preach and teach, to care and admonish, to counsel, and so much more. Oversee, meaning acting as faithful representatives of Jesus himself to the flock. Admonish, instructing, that is correcting as well as warning, speaking as if it is Jesus himself speaking. The sheep, respect, appreciate, honoring Jesus is extending respect and love to the one given to look after them. Esteem, this is much more than just a love attitude. This love is in word and in deed. Not just towards the pastor, not just towards the shepherd, but towards each and every one in the flock. Submit and be at peace. Submitting and be peaceable under the authority of the pastor. This is the only way of eliminating conflict in the house. Skinder, strife, all the things that's happening at our workplaces, but we cannot allow it inside the house. It's our responsibility, each and every one of ours, it's our responsibility to make sure we don't allow it. That there will be peace and harmony in the house, between the flock. And in this, the efficiency of living as a well and a taken care of flock is possible when we do it together. This is promoting a healthy church in our town. An unhealthy church does not bring people to Jesus. An unhealthy church does not attract people. Only a healthy and a strong, a looked after church promotes Jesus as well as the gospel. That is the reason why both the shepherd and the flock have to work together for the same goal, building the church, growing in Christ. The devil is out there to stop a healthy church. The devil is out there to scatter the flock. We see it day in and day out. How many churches are you aware of that is still having sermons on a Sunday evening? Very few. Because the flock is scattered. But God gave both the pastor and the congregation something to help. Something to grow. Something to assist. Something to encourage one another. Caring for one another. Praying for one another. Not neglecting the gatherings. But the greatest of all the equipment that we received, the greatest of everything that we received to be part of this house, to be part of this family, is His Spirit, Holy Spirit. We have nothing else that we can really and truly claim, it's mine. We can claim him because he is ours. The question that I'm asking tonight is, how much of him do you want? How much of him do you need? You see, we hear the word. We understand the word. But how much are you taking to eat? That seed. The seed that you receive. How much of that seed are you willing to plant? How much is the desire inside of you? Because it's at the end of the day, it's about you. It's about you doing what God called you to do with a gift that is given you. To go out into the marketplace and love. To care. How much are we doing in the marketplace? How much are we doing at work? The tool that we received, his name is Holy Spirit. And I want to say to you tonight, there is no better tool than that. There's no better equipment. There's no better advice. There's no better help. But then, how much will you allow it? Because you've been led to green pastures. You've been fed the correct nourishing food. How much are you willing to go out and be an example of what you have, what you received? Holy Spirit, our guidance, our teaching. The one who loves us, the one who adores us, the one who wants to walk with us. Take his hand. Take his hand and make it personal. Amen. Father, we are privileged. We are privileged because of what you are giving us. Not once, Lord, that you turn any of us away. No matter how many times, Lord, we wandered away. No matter how many times, Lord, we failed you. You did not show us away. You've given us a new opportunity. Lord, you've given people in the house to look after and to take care of, to love and to comfort. Your people. My prayer this evening, Lord, is that they that's in the house, those that's listening to the message this evening, Lord, that they will make the decision to the desire that you've given inside of us, Lord, that we will be so hungry, and let this desire be a flame in our hearts, driving us. So that we can do what you've called us to do. To go out into the marketplace. To go out into the streets, Lord. And minister unto those in need. It's so easy to say, I give you some money and go do or go buy. But so many times, Lord, that is not what a person wants. A person just wants to hear God loves you. And many times a person just wanted to hear, I care for you. So many times a person just wanted to know that I am valued. But we missed it. We missed it for so long. Lord, help us that we as a congregation will start to cry together for each other. Lord, that we will cry for the ones together that must come back home. That we will cry together, Lord, for that desire to flame up in persons' hearts, longing to come back home. I'm grateful, Lord, for your word, because your word is teaching us your ways. Your word is teaching us the ways that you've got planned for us. Help us, Lord, that we will start to spend more time, valuable time in your word. And that will inflame this desire for more of you. Thank you for Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, thank you that you lead us. Thank you that you are there with us. Thank you for teaching us. We love you so much. Holy Spirit, we love you so much. So many times we don't have the words. But I know you know the words because you know the heart. Help us that we will no longer use the excuse of God knows my heart. But that we will rather start to say, I know God's heart. And according to God's heart, I will do. And I praise you for that this evening, God. Thank you for the house. Thank you for each and every one in this house that's caring for our house. Thank you for this evening, Lord. And we praise you only in the name of Jesus.